kind of into the partying scene and all that. I was really living for myself, almost selfish living. It was a Wednesday. I decided to go to the 7 p.m. service, and that message, it was Pastor Jim preaching, and I just felt like it was geared towards me. And he did the altar call, he looked in my direction, I knew God was calling me, it wasn't a coincidence. So I raised my hand, I went down that altar, and from that day forward, I was born again and my life just changed for the better. It was just complete opposite. Started getting closer and closer in my relationship with the Lord. Then he started to reveal some things about my own personal life. From then on, I heard about the Bible college, I enrolled, and since I started the Bible college, God has taught me many great things, so many revelations, from obedience to showing love and mercy and compassion. And ever since then, my life has really turned around for the better. All my life and as a kid, I've always wanted to be in the military. And now that I was older, I was able to have the opportunity to follow my dreams and pursue that. And that was at the same time that I was getting closer in my relationship with the Lord. So I had prayed about it over the summer before actually taking that first step and enrolling in the Air Force Reserve Officer Training Corps. It's something I've always wanted, but I just felt that God wasn't on board. And through the classes at the Rock Bible College, more specifically the Understanding Biblical Authority class, I learned that partial obedience is actually disobedience. So I was living in a gray area, and I said, enough is enough, I'm gonna give God my 100%. God actually made a way. He turned things around completely. And the following year, I re-enrolled in the program, and just everything was so much better. And because I did so, I'm gonna be graduating with 3 degrees instead of one. And I'm also I also received a pilot slot. So God just took things to a whole nother level. And because of that 100% obedience and faithfulness to God, regardless of the circumstances and the risks that were at hand, God just made a way when there were no doors open, and He's the one that can open those doors. Bible college really changed my life. It took me from here to here in my relationship with God. And if He can do that with someone like me, a wretch like me that was living in disobedience in high school and kind of fell away, He can do that for you as well. So I highly encourage you to just take that first step and enroll in Bible college. If it's on your heart, then go ahead and do it. And it's just that much more in your relationship with God. So I encourage you all to enroll and sign up.
Check, check.
Hello. It's a wonderful honor to be with you tonight. My name is Michael Witherspoon. I am the 2015 Rock Bible College class president. Lions of the tribe of Judah, we did it. We did it. Hallelujah. I would like to first thank God. By His grace, we made it. I want to thank Pastors Jim and Deborah Cobray for being faithful stewards and starting the Bible College. You have been a tremendous role model to us all. Thanks to our all-star team of faculty that are loaded with wisdom and passion to share the revelation they've received through the years of ministry. You guys have imparted so much on all of our lives. I want to thank Ruth Reeves and Regina Ross for faithfully serving the college week after week, even at times off, always committed to serving with excellence and with joy. I want to thank Dr. Fred Adams for being a disciplined role model and a dean and a man of God to us all. Thank you. Thank you very much. I would like to take a moment to thank the family members, the friends, and all that are here gathered to support that sowed into each student through prayer, long-suffering with us, and encouraging us. We just want to thank you guys for being here. Personally, I want to thank my close circle of friends, Rachel Valkersell, my old roommate Joshua Burgos, Jason and Elena Piper. I remember when we wrote our sermons for our homiletics class, And we drilled and we drilled and we drilled. Our pulpit was my ironing board. It was in our living room, and it was, you know, I just want to thank you guys for being critical with us, you know, in the critiquing, and we were blessed, and we grew together. So I just want to thank you guys. I want to thank my parents, my mom, who, she got born again, and she got enrolled in the Rock Bible College, and she just was set on fire. She just took off. I watched her flourish like a palm tree and grow strong like a cedar in Lebanon. Thank you, Mom, for being hungry for Jesus and continuing to strive to know him deeper and deeper every day. Thank you, Mom. I just want to encourage the rest of you that are in your first year or those of you who are considering going to Bible college. It says in Psalm 103, "Bless the Lord, all my soul, and let me not forget all of his benefits." God is very active in our lives, and spreading the good work he is doing in us and for us stirs up the righteousness of God. So please do share your praise reports. I want to share Psalm 92:12. It says, "Those that are planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God." If we stay in the house of God, we will grow strong in wisdom, and the assembling of the saints gives us good godly fellowship, accountability, and the corporate anointing. To the first-year students, don't grow weary while doing good, for in due season you shall reap harvest. I would like to take this moment to welcome up the faculty to the stage. If you guys would please join me. And I'd like to hand this off to the Honorable Dr. Fred Adams.
Welcome, and thank you for coming. And you guys look so good. Yes. First, what I'd like to do is I just would like to address the entire student body. I want to thank each one of you for your decision and your dedication and your commitment to the Biblical Studies program. Tonight, each of you, you all have something significant to celebrate. You have completed something extremely significant. For some of you, you've completed your first year of Biblical Studies. For others, your second year, meaning you've completed the entire program. And there's a few of you which have completed your fourth year and will be receiving your bachelor degree tonight. Yes. Amen. Let's give them a hand. Personally, as the director of the college, it's my desire to advance the college, to make it the most influential learning institution for biblical studies in Southern California. To accomplish this, change and evaluation must be ongoing. It's an ongoing process. And along with that, there has to be goals that support measurable objectives. The mission and the academic system that the Bible College embodies has a couple of key important elements that are necessary to affect a continual change and a lasting change in the lives of those that attend the college. And they are as follows. The college places a real high value and importance on how people are treated. The college places a high value on how people are developed. Also, the college values how people prosper And then I think most significantly, the college places a value on service and contributions that benefit humanity. So, graduating class of 2015, you have studied to show yourselves approved. Workmen, fit for the master's use. As graduates from this institution, you are empowered and are able to impact those whose lives you touch as you serve in your sphere of influence. Proverbs 19, verse 2, it says, enthusiasm without knowledge is no good. Haste makes mistakes. Graduates, I charge you to take the knowledge that you have gained and be enthusiastic about continuing your pursuit for God. As Pastor Luke so eloquently described and explained in his message on the pursuit of God, the definition of pursuit is to go after something with great intent. You enrolled in Bible college in pursuit of God. And I say to you, do not allow your receipt of your diploma to be a note of completion. I say to you to continue your pursuit. With great intent, and allow your diploma to be a key that opened doors of ministry for you. So I close with this verse from Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 10. No matter what you do, work at it with all your might. I thank you from the bottom of my heart for allowing the Rock Bible College the opportunity to serve you. Thank you. And now I'd like to introduce the valedictorian. The valedictorian is an academic title that's conferred upon a student who delivers the valedictory address. It's the close, it's the farewell statement to the graduating class. And with that explanation, I'd like to bring Miss Neela Kong to the stage.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome. Pastors, teachers, instructors, our graduates, family, and friends. My name is Neelam, and it's an honor to be up here as your valedictorian. None of this would be possible without the vision of the Rock Bible College founders, President and Vice President Pastors Jim and Deborah Cobray. Thank you for providing this experience. A safe place where we can experience God on a whole deeper level. I'd like to thank Director of the Rock Bible College, Dr. Fred Adams, for your commitment to preparing us students for our purpose. I'd like to also thank all instructors, faculty, administration, and the Student Council for your time and effort to invest in us. Thank you, various families, friends, all for coming to celebrate this victory with us. It would not have been possible without your patience and support. I know you guys have put up with a lot with us. I've personally got out of a lot of dishwashing, so I'm super thankful for that for about 2 years. Thank you, Jesus. And then I'd like to personally thank my crew, my sister, Yasmin, and Nicholas, who did this journey with me. You guys spoke life into me. You supported me when I needed it the most. And you helped my stomach with brain food with your delicious baking skills, so thank you. So graduates, I am so proud of your achievement. Please give yourselves a hand. I know many of us are just thankful to pass Dr. Reverend Adams' classes. I know I am. Don't know if it was a mystery or overwhelming grace, but thank you. But as we come to this season of our lives, this is the end of a season for us, and many of us are just wondering what we're going to do from here or where we're going to go. What are we going to do with what we've learned in our instruction in Bible college? Well, I'd like to help with that, to provide clarity and a little bit of encouragement to discuss purpose. Purpose is defined as deliberate intention or the reason for which something exists, and knowing your purpose is perfect for the end of the season because it propels us to seek the Father for further understanding of where we fit in our personal mission field. So everything has a unique purpose for which it was created. And I know when many of us started, we just wanted to get closer to God. We just wanted to, you know, see where this would go. But I know each and every one of you students, along with myself, are not the same person who we were when we first started. So we were unintentionally seeking our purpose, and to know our purpose is to know who we are and what we're doing. And I believe 2 Timothy 1:9 gives us the foundational answer for this. It says, God has called us to a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose. Our true purpose is found in the relationship with our Creator. And he made you, each one of you, so distinctly unique. He has fashioned you with his own hands, and he has put himself inside of you. So I want you to know and leave with this today, nobody can fulfill the calling that you can and what he's destined you to do. And your highest form of satisfaction will come from achieving your purpose. Despite your purpose being so unique to you, it is also the relationships that you've made along the way. So whatever relationships you've made in Bible college, I pray that they would edify you and you would use these to build others up in the future as you go to your personal mission field. To give a small testimony of my journey, I had no idea the roller coaster that I would have to go through in Bible college. I mean, I went through so much personal breaking from almost losing my sister, losing my cousin, and having to make very hard life decisions. I wasn't even sure if I was going to make it out like the same, but God's faithfulness and grace was so overwhelming. And now as I look back, I'm grateful and I'm thankful because I know that it has prepared me for my purpose. So I know many of you can relate with doctor's notes or family issues, whatever you've gone through. I pray that you would use your purpose with intention. Use these Bible college testimonies to build others up. And remember, nobody can disqualify you from your purpose. Christ has already qualified you with all that you'll need for your journey. And I pray that you continue to seek your purpose so that in the end you will hear, well done, good and faithful servant. I'd like to finish this by blessing all the graduates from Colossians 1, 9 through 12. I pray that you would be filled with the knowledge of his will. In all wisdom and spiritual understanding, I pray that you would walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing him, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. I pray that you would be strengthened with all might according to his glorious power for all patience, long-suffering with joy, giving thanks to the Father, who has qualified us to be partakers of inheritance of the saints of the light. You have a wonderful life ahead of you, and I encourage you to go pursue your purpose. Thank you. Dr. Fred Adams.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes. Wonderful. Great job. Thank you very, very much. You know, the college is really puts a big emphasis on giving honor to whom honor is due. And we have added a special award, which we will continue to do from this point forward. So this is the very first time we're going to do this. We are giving an award and a presentation for perfect attendance. This is an award that goes to, what this means is this: a person who has not missed one day of classes in a two-year period of time. Every Tuesday and Thursday, this individual was there. Now, I didn't know this, but I found out that this individual had a challenge with his mother, was in the hospital, and I believe it was on a class day, I'm not sure, but somehow he was able to work it out and take care of his mom and yet still make it to class. And I'm not sure if he went back to the hospital after class. I don't know, but I mean, it says commitment. We all have challenges in our life. And as you students very well know, as soon as you begin Bible college, it's like los demonios. That's Swahili for the devil, right? It's amazing, you know. So you're doing something that affects a change in your life, because that change in your life is going to affect the change in what happens in the people, in the lives of the people that you touch. But I'd like to bring Stephen Ashton to the stage. Yes. Yes. Yeah, you can stand. Stephen, congratulations, man.
I didn't know you had spies. Intel.
Would you stand here? We're going to take a photo of you. This is yours, my man. Yeah. Thank you. God bless you, man. Yeah. Right on. Right on. Very good. Now, each year, to continue the presentation of awards, each year the college selects an outstanding student from the Rock Bible College, as well as a student who is participating in the International School of Ministry Biblical Studies program. So this award is never given for academic achievement. It's given based on the student's ability to show maturity in those areas which are a matter of heart, such as character, credibility, integrity, persistence, as well as ministry service, attendance, class participation, spiritual lifestyle, relationship with fellow classmates, professional demeanor, and leadership. And I would like to ask Dr. Baron Gilfillan, ISOM president and founder, and his lovely wife, Dr. Lisa Gilfillan, the founder of Good Shepherd Ministry, co-founder of Good Shepherd Ministries, and the director of Women of the World Ministries, if you would please come stand with me while we make this presentation to the International School of Ministry Outstanding Student. And Sheila Bowman, if you would please come to the platform. Yes. And Ruth, if you'd step in here. Yes. Congratulations. Thank you. Okay. Now this year, the Rock Bible College Outstanding Student Award will be given to a very special person who has touched the lives of the student body, the faculty, and many of you who attend the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. And that person is Sylvia Patty Cota. Woo! Patty first enrolled in the Rock Bible College in August, on August the 14th, 2012. She had been battling cancer. She had stage 3 cancer when she actually enrolled. She battled cancer for 3 years, had been battling for 3 years, and then she was actually on a fixed income and was only working about 20 hours a week. Her TRBC application, it came with a request for tuition assistance because she could only afford to pay a portion of that tuition. And fortunately, there were funds available, and at the time, her request was granted. However, after having to restart the program 3 times due to medical challenges, Patty was never able to complete the program. She went to be with our Lord and Savior on March the 3rd, 2015. On March the 26th, the Rock Church hosted a memorial service to celebrate Patty's real graduation. Would you say amen to that? Amen. Okay. And there the college announced that at tonight's commencement ceremony that it would honor Patty as the TRBC Student of the Year. And to commemorate the memory of this remarkable woman, the college has created the Patty Cota Scholarship Fund as a lasting memorial and an inspiration to the faculty and to the students that attend the Rock Bible College. All contributions to this fund will be used to assist those individuals who desire to attend college and are not financially able to do so. I would like to ask the president and founder of the Rock Bible College, Pastor Jim Cobray, to come and help me present this. And I want to apologize tonight that Pastor Deborah is not feeling well. We'll keep her in her prayer, in our prayers, but she would be here also. But Pastor Jim, let's just welcome Patty Cota's children to come and receive her award. We just want to say to you that we love your mom. We know we didn't love your mom as much as you did, but I'm telling you, we actually love your mom. She was wonderful. She was just a powerful woman. She inspired this entire student body as well as many, many members here of the church. It's amazing. God bless you. Thank you. And that brings us to this evening's commencement address, which will be delivered by Reverend Mike Keyes. My God. The Rock Bible College has supported Reverend Mike Keyes, his ministry, for many, many years, in fact, decades. Reverend Mike is an apostle. As an apostolic ministry to the Philippines. He oversees large portions of the body of Christ in hundreds of churches. His crusades, they reach thousands, and there's just hundreds of salvations and hundreds of healings that go on in his meetings. He submitted himself to the leadership of the Rock Church. He considers this as his home church. And I want to recognize his lovely wife, Ethel. Ethel, if you would please wave to everybody. Yes, thank you. Thank you for allowing Reverend Mike to come. We really appreciate it. He has a special message for this graduating class, for the student body. And please, let's give him a big hand as he comes. Reverend Mike, please.
Thank you, Dr. Fred. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. It is always an honor for me to be asked to participate in ceremonies like this because it represents such hope and such potential for the future for the graduating class that is represented here tonight, as well as for all of us who attend and participate and join in celebrating their accomplishments. And so the message I have in my heart to share is a message not only for you, the graduates, but also for all of us here tonight, something that I think will help us to appreciate the magnitude of the moment and to get us ready and prepared for the days ahead, the days of battles and fights of faith that all of us will be facing in the days and weeks and years ahead should Jesus tarry. When Dr. Fred invited me to come and participate in this service and share with you the commencement address, you know, it's an honor and it's a humbling experience for me. And I would first of all like to thank him for inviting me, as well as to thank and, of course, extend to all of the staff and faculty and, of course, Pastors Jim and Debbie the opportunity to share with you this evening, as I'm going to do here in just a minute from the Word. But I want you all to know that God is very proud of you. He's proud of the effort you have exerted and put forth to bring you to this place of time in your life with all that lays ahead before you. And what I want to talk with you tonight about, and this would apply to everybody, not just to the students, not just to the graduates, but to all of us, we need to see our life, you need to see your life the way God sees it, not the way you see it. You need to realize the potential that you have because of the Holy Spirit that lives inside of you. And you need to realize that your life is a limited time offer from the Lord. We do not get an opportunity to come back around a second time and fix the mistakes we made the first time through. This is it. And so I want to begin by turning in our Bibles, if you have your Bible or your Bible device, whichever you brought with you to the service this evening. I want to start by looking at Luke chapter number 16. And I'm going to read a story to you here. We're going to comment upon a few of the things we read here and then let the Holy Spirit take it from there and take us where he wants us to go. This is a very familiar passage. It's the story of the rich man and Lazarus. Some people think this is a parable. I don't believe that it is. There is no reference to it being a parable in the Word of God. I believe these two men existed. I believe one is in heaven right now and the other is in hell. Jesus called them by name. At least he did for the one. And so beginning in the 19th verse of Luke chapter 16, this is what Jesus tells us. There was a certain rich man who was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, full of sores, who was laid at his gate, desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. And so it was that the beggar died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. Verse 23, and being in torments in Hades, he lifts up his eyes and sees Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. Then he cried out and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. Verse 25, listen to this very carefully. Abraham replies and says, Son, remember that in your lifetime, you received your good things and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he is comforted and you are tormented. Besides all this, between us and you, there is a great gulf that is fixed, so that those who want to pass from here to you cannot, nor can those from there pass to us. Then he said, I beg you therefore, Father, that you send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, that he may testify to them, lest they come to this place of torment. And Abraham said to him, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. He says in reply, no, Father Abraham, but if one goes to them from the dead, they will repent. But he said to him, if they don't hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rise from the dead. Now, you may not realize, but the reason this school was raised by the Holy Spirit, the reason any Bible school is raised up by the Holy Spirit, is so that you can share what Moses and the prophets said to people who need to know. Because he said, listen, it doesn't matter if somebody rises from the dead. If they don't hear the word of God, they will never repent anyway. And that means we are responsible for learning the word of God. We are responsible to study to show ourselves approved so that we know what to say from the word of God that will steer people in the right direction to receive eternal life. All right? And in verse 25, Abraham told the rich man, you had your chance, mister. You had a lifetime full of good things. You fared sumptuously every day. You ate fine food every day. You wore nice clothing. You lived in this big house. And every day at your gate, this man laid there full of sores, sick and dying, was out there. And at any time, you could have gone out there to help him, and you chose not to. So now you made your choices. In your lifetime, you had the good things, and he had nothing. He lived a very miserable life, but now he's comforted, and you are tormented. The tables have turned, and now they have eternal consequence for the decisions they made. And I want you to understand, class, I want you to understand your life is a limited time offer from God. And you are trained in this school to do something with the information you have received. All that you have studied is not just so that you can walk around and impress people with your knowledge of the scriptures. It is so that you can take this knowledge and go somewhere and talk to somebody about Jesus in such a way that they will receive eternal life. That is your responsibility. That is the responsibility of each and every Christian. But schools are raised up like this to help us achieve those goals and attain those objectives so that we can accurately represent Jesus wherever we go in a way that would make him proud. Amen? Amen. And this goes for everybody. We need to study to show ourselves approved, and we need to be people who know what we're talking about. The Bible says in the last days, men will be carried, tossed to and fro with every wind of doctrine and by the sleight of men with cunning craftiness and so forth. We need to know what we're talking about. And that's why you enrolled in this school, to find out more about what God is all about and what he did when Jesus died on the cross and the benefits and all of that that was made available to each and every one of us when he rose from the dead. But I want you to understand, class, your life is a limited time offer. You know, when you go down to the mall or some store somewhere, they will have seasonal sales. And when they have seasonal sales, they will put up signs on the storefront and the windows and so forth, and it will say, for a limited time only, buy one, get one free. For a limited time only, buy one, take 10% off, item number two, something of that nature. But they will always have a beginning date and an ending date to the sale. For a limited time only. It ends. All right? And someday our limited time only offer, which is our life from God, will end. And you need to take advantage, full advantage of the opportunity that God is giving you here to represent him, the opportunity to come to a school like this, to learn and to grow and then to leave this place, not only to represent this place with excellence, but to remember that you represent Jesus with excellence. That everything you do is unto the Lord in his name and for his glory. That's why you're here. That's why we are here to celebrate what you have accomplished. That's why all these people are here. That's why they've dedicated all of this time to your life and to your potential. And I want you to understand this, because this is how God sees you. It doesn't matter how other people see you. It doesn't matter what they say about you. It only matters what God says about you. And if he says that he's proud of what you're doing, and if you can stand before him someday and hear him say, well done, good and faithful servant, then your life has meant something. Your life counts for something. And all of this time and effort that you've expended here will be worth the effort when someday you stand before the Lord and you see the long line of people behind you that are there because of something you said or something you did to bring them to a closer walk with the Lord. That's the definition of your life. That's the definition of what it means to be a soldier in the army of the Lord. I want you to look with me at James chapter 4. James chapter 4, verse number 14, if you would with me. James 4, 14. In our Bible school in the Philippines, we tell the students right from the beginning, this is a hard school. Not everybody will make it to the finish line. And we tell them this because I want them to understand what the responsibilities are for those who graduate from the school. And I tell them up front, we will make this school as hard as we can for you. We will challenge you. We will make you better at what you're doing. We will force you to improve or you will leave. It is not for everybody. In our school, not everybody makes it to the finish line because I want them to understand the immense responsibility that we have been given. We've been entrusted by God to represent Him, to work in His name, to talk about eternal salvation for people. And if we don't get it right, people can be lost forever and forever. And I tell my students, if you don't understand this from the beginning, you have no place in this school. You should leave now. Don't waste my time. Here in James chapter 4, verse number 14, there is a question found. Whereas you don't know what will happen tomorrow, but here's the question. For what is your life? What is your life? And he answers, it is even a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we shall live and do this or that. But now you boast in your arrogance, and all such boasting is evil. Therefore, verse 17, to him who knows to do good and does not do it, to him it is sin. Now, if I may take those four verses and summarize what he just said here, he is defining for us what our life is and what our life is not. He says, what is your life? And then the answer comes back, it is a vapor that appears for a short time and then vanishes away. But if you know to do good during this short time called your life and you do it, then God will commend you. If you know to do good and don't, then to you it is sin. I'm 63 years old. I got saved when I was 26. I cannot believe the amount of time that has passed from that day, September 21st, 1978, until this day where I stand before you. It's hard to believe that all of this time has passed, but it has. It has gone by so quickly, and it seems the older we get, the faster things move by. Maybe because you're so young, you don't realize this, but trust me, the older ones up here know that what I'm telling you is true. And listen, it's just, it's hard to imagine this much time has passed. You look back, you see things that were done in the 1980s, 1990s, in the 2000s, and here we are halfway through the next decade, and, you know, we're still going on for God, but it's amazing how much time has passed, and you can't recover lost time. You can't go back and fix the mistakes and the disobedience from yesterday. It's gone. You can get forgiven for it, and God will move on with you, but it's lost opportunity. So if you understand your life the way it is, it's a limited time offer from God to do good as you're able to do it wherever the Lord leads you. And if you understand that, then your life becomes significant to God. There's value placed upon your life when you understand this. Instead of just being a Bible school student that walks around with a head full of knowledge, but no application to what they've learned in the real world life where they meet people and encounter people that are hurting and suffering and dying in the name of poverty and sickness and everything else that's down here because of the curse that's on this planet. You guys have been taught and trained to do better and to represent this school with excellence and to represent the body of Christ with excellence and, more importantly, to represent Jesus with excellence. Amen. And your life is not about what you can obtain, what you can have, what you can buy, what you can enjoy. It's all about how effective you are in sharing Jesus with other people. Amen. That's it. There's nothing else down here that God cares about. He does not care about our cars, our homes, our phones, our clothing. He does not care about any of this. All that he cares about are souls. It's amazing how many churches have lost sight of this over the years. I've watched them drift away from their original vision and calling. I've watched it. They just get so caught up in pleasing men, they forget they're out here to please God. Never mind the men. Look with me at Jeremiah 45, verse 5. Jeremiah 45, verse 5. Old Testament. Thank you, Jesus. Jeremiah 45, and verse 5, the last verse of the chapter. God has a message here for us as well as for them way back when. He says, another question, and do you seek great things for yourself? That's a good question. Do you seek great things for yourself? Do you go to school so that you can graduate and kind of walk around and spread your feathers and check me out because I'm a graduate and I've gone to school and you haven't? Do you seek great things for yourself? Do not seek them. For behold, I will bring adversity upon all flesh, says the Lord. But I will give, listen to this, I will give your life to you as a prize in all places wherever you go. God says, I will give you as a prize to people wherever you go. They may not fully understand what is going on. They may not fully understand who you are. But as far as God's concerned, he's giving you to people as a prize. You are their trophy. You are representing Jesus. And to God, you mean everything to him because you have the words of eternal life. And this is what Peter talked about when Jesus said, you know, who do men say that I am and so on? And they all said the wrong thing. And then Peter said, I know who you are. You're the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus said, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah. Flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. Meaning to say you are responsible for what you know. You're responsible for what you've learned. And all of you here are responsible for what God has used this faculty and speakers like me and Pastor Jim and Pastor Deborah and all of us to impart and to inspire and to encourage you with. Amen. And he wants you to leave this school and go out there and turn your world upside down for Jesus. Wherever you go, go in the power of the Lord. Go in the name of Jesus, amen, and torment the devil everywhere you turn. Let me tell you something. The devil should be afraid you're waking up in the morning. Amen. He should be running for cover. For most Christians, they're so confused, they can't find the floor when they wake up in the morning. But for people like you, praise God, you've got something, you've been taught, you've been trained. Now take all that weaponry and go out there and turn the world upside down in the name of Jesus. That's your responsibility. Amen. The true riches in life are not possessions that you can buy. The true riches in life are souls saved and lives changed. Rich people, as far as God's concerned, are not people that own things, have things, and buy things. Rich people, as far as God is concerned, are people who win souls. And the more they win souls, the richer they become in the eyes of the Lord. Amen. I want to be rich as far as God's concerned. I want the true riches. I don't care about the rest of it. The Bible says if we seek first the kingdom of God, everything else will be given to us. Amen. So I want you to know this. I want you to be encouraged tonight and to understand that you are a prize given by God to somebody out there that's praying for help tonight, and you are the answer. Somebody's out there seeking help, needing help from Jesus, and you are the answer. God's going to send you to help them. Amen. He is your prize, and you are their prize. Praise the Lord. It's something that, you know, it's hard to wrap your mind around how God, so perfect and so wonderful, would limit his activity on the earth to partnership with people like you and me. That's amazing, as far as I'm concerned, because we're works in progress. None of us have arrived. The only one who did this perfect from start to finish was Jesus. Everybody else struggles as we go. We learn as we grow. All right? But praise the Lord, he chooses to work with us anyway. All right? Look with me at Proverbs. Let me see. Proverbs 27, I do believe, is where I want to go. Yeah. 27, verse 21. And I'll leave you with this thought from this verse. Proverbs 27 and 21. Okay? Years ago, God used this verse to help propel me into the ministry to where I am today. Thank you, Jesus. And I want to share it with you here tonight. Proverbs 27, verse 21. The Word of God says, the refining pot is for silver and the furnace for gold. And a man is valued by what others say of him. Now, I meditated on that verse for a long time, and I sought the Lord as to what exactly he was saying here. It says, a man is valued by what others say of him. Not what God says, but what others say. And so I sought the Lord for help to understand what he's telling us here, and he said, listen, you need to understand, I'm no respecter of persons. I love everybody equally. I love everybody all across the world. I have no favorites. I play no favorites. I love every person, every human being the same. Their value to me in my world of influence is equal across the board. I love everybody the same. But you have to understand, he said, it's not what I think about you. It's what other people say about you that puts value on your life as far as I'm concerned. And then he said this. He said, let me tell you, the length of the line of the people in heaven that are there because of you, because of something you said or something you did or someplace you went in my name because I told you to go and you went and lives were changed. If those people are in heaven and you stand before me to be judged and that line behind you represents the people you reached, that defines the value of your life. When you are being judged and they say, Jesus, if it wasn't for that person, I wouldn't be here. If they didn't go to Africa, I wouldn't be here. If they didn't answer the call, if they didn't pray in the middle of the night, I don't think I would have made it. He said, the longer the line, the more value your life has to me. The shorter the line, the less value you have to me. And if there is no line, then your life was a waste of time. You're saved. Thank God you're in heaven. But what did you do? What lives did you touch? What countries did you affect? What towns did you turn upside down for the Lord? The longer that line, the more value you have for God. That's the definition of value as far as God's concerned. And I'll leave you with this story that I experienced when I was a student at Bible school back in 1980, when I went to school, and then I left for the Philippines, and you've heard the story. I was in class. There were 1,700 students that day in class, and a guest missionary was called upon to speak at the school and to address the students. His name was Ernie Reb. Ernie Reb was an Assemblies of God missionary who spent his life working in the Philippines. And because I had already been called by God to the Philippines, I was ready to write, you know, take notes and listen what this guy's got to say. He's been there. He knows what he's doing, you know. He's spent his whole life there. He's had crusades, you know. And so I'm sitting there with bated breath, waiting to hear what this guy's got to say. Ernie Reb. And so the missions director invited him to come up, and he came up, and he had his notes, and he had his Bible, and he was ready to share something. He had about, 45 minutes to share. It was a time called Share and Praise, and every day, they had a singing group or a guest speaker or a visiting missionary. You never knew what it was. Well, this day it was this guy. And he came up to the platform, and he opened up his notes, and he started to speak. He got to his notes, and you could tell God was dealing with him. He kept looking at his notes, and he's in front of 1,700 students, and I'm one of them. And he took a look at the notes. He kept staring at his notes, and then he stopped, and he took a long pan across the auditorium from his left across to his right. It took him about a minute to do it, and you can imagine there's silence in the auditorium. People don't know what he's doing, what's going on. You could have heard a pin drop in that auditorium. They're all staring at him. What is he doing? Cross, he took a good look at everybody. Put his hands on the side of the pulpit like this. I can remember it. It was 30 some years ago. I can still remember it as if it was yesterday because it made the most profound impact upon my life. He put his hands on the side of the pulpit. He looked down. There was a tear in his eye. He stepped back from the pulpit like this, took another look at everybody, then walked back to the pulpit. And if I can just, in a limited sense, just repeat what he said the way he said it. All he said was this. He said, do any of you students know what it means for a man to perish? That's all he said. If he ever said another word, I never heard it. You could have heard a pin drop. People were crying. The power of God fell into that room. And he sat down. That was his message. And that year, we had Oral Roberts, we had Kenneth Hagin, we had the who's who of faith people that came through and gave sermons. That one question, that one sermon, that one moment changed my life. Do any of you students know what it means for a man to perish? And over the years, I've never forgotten because it's been my observation that most Christians do not know what it means for men to perish. Most Bible school students don't know what it means for men to perish. But if you ever get the revelation of it and you understand the purpose for why you're in this school and what you've spent the last 2 years investing your time to learn about and to be trained to do, then you'll never forget what it means for men to perish. And you'll take all this information and go out from these doors and represent Jesus, as I've said, with excellence, and torment the devil every which way, everywhere you go. That's what it means. I am not going to stand before the Lord with blood on my hands. And I don't want you to either. Amen? So I charge you, we all charge you, in the name of Jesus, go out from these doors with excellence and never forget that men are perishing all around us. And to the best of our ability, our job is to be in the right place at the right time with the right message to turn souls from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to the power of God. That's why we're all here. Amen? Amen. All right. God bless you. Before we proceed with the ceremony and everything on the program, I want to take an opportunity for anyone here this evening that is not sure of their salvation. We're talking about your soul. These students have invested time in their lives to prepare to go out and talk to people about the condition of their soul. And if you're here tonight as a visitor, as a family member, or someone who's just here because, you know, you're here, then I have news for you. You're going to heaven or you're going to hell, and if you die lost, you will perish. You will perish. And it is a horrible thing beyond description what happens to a man or woman who dies without Jesus. The whole reason for why this school was raised up, the whole reason for why this church was built, was so that we could talk to you and give you the opportunity to change direction. As I said earlier today in our services earlier in the morning, we have choice. We have the power of choice. We can choose Jesus. We have that ability. The devil can't stop you. If you decide to turn your life around, the devil can't do a thing about it. He will try to influence you and cause you not to choose Jesus. But here tonight, you can make the decision. You can turn things around. You can go from hell to heaven in just that flash of time when you decide, I am going to serve the Lord, and I'm going to serve the Lord and Him alone and nobody else. And so I'm here tonight to invite you, to encourage you, and to implore you to please make that decision tonight while you're here, while you still have breath in your lungs, while you still have the power of choice, to make this decision. All right? Don't assume you can do this tomorrow. You might be dead before the sun rises. You have no idea. All around the world tonight, people are dying. And most of them don't know Jesus. And most of them don't even think they're going to hell. And most of them are going to hell. May it not be so for you. Here tonight, you have an opportunity. I want you to get your life right. We want you to get your life right. We want you to spend eternity with us and all these graduates in heaven someday. When we end this life, step out from this body and go home. And go up rather than going down. Because if you start to go down after you die, you have nowhere else to go. Your choice has been taken from you and you will descend. You can cry out and scream all you want. God will never answer. He'll answer you now if you cry out now. If you die without accepting Jesus, you have sealed your fate. And there's nothing you can do about it. And every single soul in hell, if they had one more choice to get saved and to accept Jesus, they would all accept him. But they'll never get that chance. Never, ever, ever. So here's your opportunity. I will count to three. I'm not going to ask you to stand. I won't ask you to come down. We're not going to embarrass you. The service tonight is for other reasons. But if you need Jesus, when I reach three, you put your hand up and I will recognize it. And then we'll tell you, we'll give you some instructions about how you can take the next step as to why you put your hand up. But if you need help tonight, put that hand up. If you need Jesus, get the hand up there. If you've drifted away and you're not serving the Lord and you once were on fire for God and now you're not, put your hand up. Get your life right. Turn things around while you still can. That's what I'm going to offer to you, all right? Now, if you're here tonight and you're already saved, you should be praying. You should be praying for the people that are ready to make a decision that will change the course of their life. All right? I'm going to count to three. It's not a feeling. It's a choice. Choose Jesus. I'm telling you to choose Jesus. I'm not asking. I'm telling you. Choose him. Choose life. Choose heaven. Because it's a wonderful place. And all you have to do is say yes. Amen. All the hard work was done by Jesus on the cross. He did all the hard work. All we have to do is accept it. It's very simple, all right? So, when I reach three, put that hand up if I'm talking to you, all right? One, two, three. Put that hand up if I'm talking to you. I see hands back there. Thank you. God bless you. Hands. I see hands. Thank you, Lord. Anyone else? Even if just one person gets saved, it's worth it all. Thank you for the hand. Anybody else? Thank you, Jesus. God bless you. If you know you need help, put that hand up. Let me see it. We won't embarrass you, but we want you to know we love you. We love you enough to tell you the truth. Thank you for the hands. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. God bless you. All right. I want you to know we have trained workers, and Dr. Fred will give instructions as to what you can do to meet with them on your way out and talk to them about why that hand went up and what you do because of why the hand went up. We want you to know we love you, we care for you, and this church is here for you. Amen. And for you students, we're very proud of you. We're proud of what you've done, but we're more excited about what you're going to do. Take all the information you've received, all the knowledge you've acquired and accumulated, and go somewhere and do something with it meaningful for the Lord. Amen? God bless you. Thank you.
Okay, all of those who raised your hand to accept the Lord as your personal Savior, I'd like everyone to bow their heads, and let's just say a quick little prayer. Those of you, you don't accept the Lord by just raising your hand. You have to have him. You have to ask him into your heart. God will come into your heart when you ask him. So let's just bow our heads, and just everybody repeat after me. Dear Father in heaven, I thank you for dying for my sins. I ask you to come into my life. I ask you to live within me. And from this moment forward, I will live my life for you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Now those of you, thank you. Those of you that accepted the Lord as your personal Savior, as we exit tonight, as we dismiss at the doors, there will be spiritual personal trainers. That's someone that is willing to give you information to let you know what the next step is, to help you further this decision and further your walk with God. You have made a very, very, very important decision. Just like Reverend Mike said, I mean, it's the beginning of the rest of your life. Amen. I want to thank you for making that decision. Amen. Glory. And now what we'd like to do at this particular point in time is we would like to have the presentation of the graduates. We're going to do this in a manner to where we will have the first year students. We'll call you first. Those are the students that have completed their first year. They will receive their certificate of completion for the very first year. And then, after that, we will call the class of 2015 forward. So with that, I'd like to call Pastor Dr. Kobernick. If you would come forward, please. As your mic will understand.
International School of Ministry, Biblical Studies Diploma, Spanish Program. Nube Estrada. Laura Naranjo Castillo. Elizabeth Godinez. Mirna Acevedo. Norma Miranda. Bertha Espinosa. Monica Chavez. Okay, receiving certificates for the completion of the first year of the International School of Ministry Biblical Studies Diploma in English. Juan Cornejo. Linda Pitchford. Alden West. Diego Uribe. Marilyn Bigham. Sarah Bigham. Tangela Logan. Jennifer Gonzalez. Nick Gonzalez. Receiving certificates for the completion of the first year of the Rock Bible College Biblical Studies Associate's degree in e-learning. Anthony Valdez. Regina Jones Marshall. Ingrid Armstrong. Victoria Valencia. By the way, you can enroll and participate in our e-learning program from the Philippines or Saudi Arabia or Russia or anywhere. Or if you have relatives who would like a Bible college program, they can do it that way. It's great. Certificates for the completion of the first year of the Rock Bible College Biblical Studies Associate Degree Program, Miguel Santana. Priscilla Enciso. Lionel Nava. Elizabeth Luna. Leanna Seha. Ines Patricia Cadavid. Francis Jimenez. Emidio Jimenez. Josh Lopez. Deanna Gatlin. David Gatlin. Nick Rodriguez. Michael Tanita. Sandra Alba. Sarah Brooks. Maureen Ardia. Michael Reitz. Lorena Contreras. Mia Banks. Dylan Holland. Daisy Duran. Kelly Morse. Sandra Fletcher. Aura Robinson. Harvey Vitorkiewicz. Leticia Vitorkiewicz. Jamal Harris. Rosemary Duran. Audia Sunda. Barbara Boykin. Heather Gallardo. Yuvia Perez. Wilma Witherspoon. Sasha Adame. Melissa Schulze. Gallegos. Tamara Barnes. Now receiving the bachelor's degree for the International School of Ministry Biblical Studies Bachelor's Degree Program. Are we ready? Dr. Barron and Dr. Lisa. All right, with highest honors, Marianne Kirkfleet. With honors, Ronnie Lopez. With honors, Norma Lopez. With honors, Renee Smith. With highest honors, Perry O'Brien. Highest honors, Sheila Bowman. Receiving diplomas now for the International School of Ministry Diploma Spanish Program. With honors, Leila Castro. Juana Dominguez. Maritza Roca. Now we're moving on to receiving the associate's degree for the Rock Bible College Biblical Studies Associate Degree e-learning program. With honors, Mario Balderas. Highest honors, Joshua Berghaus. With highest honors, LaShawn McClinton. Students receiving associate's degree for the Rock Bible College Biblical Studies Associate Degree Program, with highest honors, Leola Allman. Elvia Torres. Ida Tovar. Rosemary Torres. Jessica Baldonado. With honors, Howard Cato Cooper. With honors, Ruth Craw. With highest honors, Myshika Moore. Angela Apodaca. With highest honors, Susan Valencia. Paulina Cardoso. Brittany Hoban. Liliana Arzate. Wayne Baskis Jr. Joseph Reyes. With highest honors, Harry McDermott. With highest honors, Mary Sidney. Rachel Lenore Mays. Christopher Roberts. Rogers. With honors, Crystal Skaggs. Highest honors, Brad Andrews. Eduardo Ochoa. Nicholas Phillips. With highest honors, Yasmin Khan. With highest honors, Neelam Khan. With honors, Michael Witherspoon. With highest honors, Luigi Gomez. With highest honors, Stephen Ashton. With highest honors, Kip Anguiano. With honors, Jacina Ruiz. With highest honors, Kathy Obeso.
Graduating class of 2015, please stand. On behalf of the TRBC faculty and the accrediting body, I confer upon you the degree of Associates and Bachelors of Biblical Studies, graduating class of 2015. You may move your tassels to the left. Glory. And I would like to ask the congregation if you would please remain in your seats as the graduates exit in the recessional. Allow the graduates to exit the sanctuary, please. Thank you. I'd like to say to those of you that accepted the Lord as your personal Savior, as you exit the auditorium at the doors, it will be SPTs. It's a spiritual personal trainer, someone who will give you very important information to assist you in your walk with the Lord as you move forward. I want to thank each of you for coming to the commencement ceremonies. I want to make note that out in the outer foyer, there is a recessional with cake and coffee and drinks. And I'd like the congregation, I'd like all of you to stand as I pronounce a blessing on you. Just raise your hands as I pray. Father, I pray a blessing on these, your people. I ask that you would bless them in the cities, bless them in the field. And with a loud voice, out loud, we say that the Inland Empire shall be saved. Amen. Thank you. God bless you.